Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome you here at the Diplomatic Academy. It is actually one of the first events in the new academic year, which is going to start officially with a great celebration on Thursday. Great celebration because we are celebrating the 50th anniversary of the founding of the Diplomatic Academy. It was refounded, I should say, in 1964 by then Foreign Minister Bruno Kreisky. So we are now 50 years old, we are in the best years, and I'm sure that for the next 50 years we are going to flourish. It's a great pleasure to welcome you for a very interesting event, a very interesting lecture by the President of the Constitutional Court of the Republic of Kosovo, Enver Hasani, and I welcome you. He's going to talk on the role of Constitutional Court in the development of the rule of law in Kosovo. As a lawyer myself, I don't have to tell you how much I value the work of constitutional courts, because they are essential. They are the key factor in maintaining and developing the rule of law. And it's a great pleasure to welcome you. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank the Embassy of the Republic of Kosovo. We welcome the Chargé, Mr. Brian Kanai. Welcome and thank you very much for helping us to organize the event. I would also like to thank our moderator, Helmer Dubis, who is from the press, from the foreign policy desk. And I thank him in particular because it makes my task much easier. As you can hear, I still have problems talking a bit, because I had an operation, so it will take a little time until my speech comes back. I hope you can understand me, but thanks to our moderator, he will be the one who will introduce our speaker for tonight. So, welcome, and I hope that in the course of the next 10 months, many of you will come again and again to our very interesting events at the Diplomatic Academy. I am pleased to give the floor to the Chargé d'Affaires of the Embassy of the Republic of Kosovo. You have the floor, sir.
And so, Mr. President Hasani, Ambassador Winlow, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to welcome you in such a large number and also to express gratitude for your interest in today's lecture of the President of the Constitutional Court of the Republic of Kosovo, Professor Dr. Enver Hasani, about the rule of the Constitutional Court on the legal system of Kosovo. Ladies and gentlemen, excellencies, if for the Constitution would be important a shaping that can justify and provide a cohesion of political community within state, then we should bear in your minds that the Republic of Kosovo is a newly established young state. As the last one coming out of the breakup of former Yugoslavia, as a secular, multicultural country with the specifics that not all states established in the 19th century have it. Furthermore, exactly the forced constitutional changes in former Yugoslavia that began in 1987 and continued through the years 1988 and 1989 were the ones that paved the way for the bloody breakup of Yugoslavia. Moreover, these constitutional changes aiming to position one nation over the other nations caused many people in Kosovo to pay with their lives while opposing such an oppressive politics. Learning from the newest history, Republic of Kosovo is investing for all people that live in it to be free in their own country, willing to provide them with conditions and opportunities while tackling that obligation by establishing a constitution that highly justifies and provides the cohesion of political, social, and cultural communities within the state that impersonates a meaningful state of law. For more on how this has been achieved, allow me to thank you for your attention and to give the floor to the President of the Constitutional Court, Mr. President Enver Hasani. Thank you.
Director Winkler, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to welcome our distinguished speaker tonight, Professor Enver Hasani, President of the Constitutional Court of the Republic of Kosovo. Mr. Hasani was appointed to the court in the year 2009 after a remarkable career as a scholar in the field of law. Having completed his studies at the universities in Pristina and Ankara, he served as an advisor for the government of Albania in the 90s. In the year 1999, he was a member of the Kosovo negotiating team at the peace conference in Rambouillet, which, as we know, didn't lead immediately to peace, but in the long run, in the year 2008, to the independence of Kosovo. Having returned to Pristina, he was appointed on top of the Faculty of Law at the University in Pristina, becoming the rector of this university in the year 2006. Mr. Hasani was born in the Kosovo town of Mitrovica, which is situated in the north of the country, and this is a town which was unfortunately in the news for, let's say, the last 15 years. So this means Mr. Hasani knows one of the crucial issues Kosovo is facing today from first sight. And yeah, Mr. Hasani, the floor is yours.
Thank you for nice words. Thank you for having me tonight to share my views on the topic regarding the role of the Constitutional Court in the rule of law in Kosovo. I would thank Director Professor Winkler, all of you, Chargé d'affaires of our embassy here in Vienna, who were instrumental in organizing this my lecture. My concept would be that I speak around 25 minutes or 30 minutes, then leave the room for others' comments or suggestions that you might be having on the on the topic. That's the topic I will be speaking, the role of the Constitutional Court in the development of the rule of law. So our court, Constitutional Court of the Republic of Kosovo, is the last or the newest one in Europe, as it is the state itself. As you know, in former Yugoslavia, most of you might know, might be familiar with it, Kosovo used to have its Constitutional Court existing along the lines of those concepts of communist constitutionalism and the unity of power, which in today's terms, of course, in liberal constitutional terms, seems paradoxical. But yet, it was one of the eight constitutional courts of the federal units of the then Yugoslavia, which in 1989 was destroyed by Serb dictator Milosevic along the vestiges of all autonomy that Kosovo enjoyed from 1974 until 1989. With the collapse of communism, Kosovo went, as you all know, its tragic history, the opposite way of other Velvet Revolutions and the libertarian movements of the former communist Europe, as did the whole of what is now defunct Yugoslavia. And the constitutional justice in former communist countries of Europe became one, I believe, one of the pillars of standing behind the new European path of newly established societies. Specificities of the struggle for constitutionalism in Kosovo compared to other societies were that, as you all know, those years Kosovo underwent or was self-organized in a parallel system of life from education to all spheres of life until 1998. That movement was led by late President Ibrahim Rugova. And with the following several years of peaceful resistance against the regime of Mr. Milosevic, then it exhausted itself as would be expected under normal circumstances of a fierce dictatorship that Europe hadn't seen since 1945. Then the war broke out under the leadership of the Kosovo, then clandestine Kosovo Liberation Army, which led eventually to war and conflict, dragging NATO alliance to intervene and stop the ongoing genocide and atrocities in the territory of Kosovo. So that in that period, one would say that Kosovo had a parallel life. In all senses, the struggle for constitutionalism was more or less as it was the historical struggle of other European nations in different periods following the modernity for human dignity and liberty. After the following the withdrawal of Serb forces from Kosovo as a result of NATO airstrikes and defeat of Mr. Milosevic's forces in Kosovo, there was a resolution, which is still formally, technically in place, of the UN Security Council, which we say of 1991, 1244, which established an administration known under the acronym UNMIC. As by definition, one might know, administration has to do about things that do not speak, not that much about the humans. That was the largest ever UN mission deployed in the world. And it had four pillars, and it had full legislative, executive, and judicial authority. It was, in fact, special representative of the Secretary General of the United Nations, was kind of, as Montesquieu would say in his L'Esprit de Loi, it's tragic for those societies if all power rests in one hand. So that was, in fact, UNMIC. All, as I said, executive, judicial, and legislative power were vested with the authority of the SRSG. Then this situation lasted more or less. We had problems in 2004, violent riots of the majority Albanian population, trying to seek more liberty and more self-government for and more ownership, if you want to, in running daily affairs. Then in 2008, as you know, Kosovo declared unilaterally independence, which 2 years later, International Court of Justice said that not only Kosovo's unilateral declaration, but every unilateral declaration of independence cannot be, because usually that's the history of other nations, for example, of Greeks and other nations centuries ago, that as such, declaration of independence is neither against general international nor specific international law, meaning resolutions of the UN Security Council. With that, we had what was known as supervised independence. Kosovo declared in its declaration of independence of 17 February 2008, declared all its intent, Kosovo leaders declared their intent to obey the highest standards of human rights and the rule of law. Then it was founded based on that constitution, based on the constitution of Kosovo, of independent and sovereign Kosovo, was created constitutional court as one of its key institutions, as it says in the article, the final authority for the interpretation of the constitution and the compliance of laws with the constitution, which is typical Kelsenian model of a constitutional court. Our constitution, for those of you who are not familiar with it, is modeled upon the constitutions of other former communist countries, and our constitutional court is modeled likewise upon other constitutional courts of Southeast Europe, being pretty active and having a key role in reframing our society along Western standards on human rights and rule of law. So the court we have both, like other, most of the courts in Europe, direct and indirect jurisdiction. But as you can see from there, the first and foremost, its classical function is compatibility with the constitution of laws, decrees of the president, prime minister, and regulations of the government. Compatibility with the constitution of municipal statutes, conflict among constitutional conflict as it is known, conflict of competences between the assembly, president, and the government. Compatibility with the constitution of a proposed referendum, so which is, there are some parts of jurisdiction which are not recognized or which are specific, both in Kosovo and elsewhere in some other countries, that reflect the local political dynamics and the complexities of Kosovo society, and the declaration of the state of emergency and the actions undertaken during the state of emergency is more or less standard, which is included in other constitutions of former communist countries of Europe. Then is compatibility of a proposed constitutional amendment with binding international agreements ratified under the constitution and the review of the constitutionality of the procedure. Kosovo is among four very rare countries that have what we say the right to preventive control of constitutional amendments, meaning that no constitutional amendment can go to the assembly to be voted unless there is a green light from the constitutional court as to their compatibility with the constitution. In doctrine, this is called theory of unconstitutional constitutional amendments, which sounds paradoxical, but in fact is meant in some societies, as I said, for example, Moldova is one of them, and very few countries recognize that, Ukraine as well, for example, and it is meant to see to both as far as form and substance of the amendments is concerned, so that new amendments do not, power to amend doesn't mean power to destroy. That's the famous saying of the Supreme Court of India, meaning that the constitutional court should check that power, as it is known, constituent power, pouvoir constituant, doesn't destroy the substance, spirit and letter of the constitution. Because through amendments, sometimes, as you know, history of Europe is in plenty of cases, through very regular constitutional procedures, have established dictatorships and fierce, Milosevic being the last one among them, in a very regular procedure. So that's why this is the specific, as I said, which is known in only four countries of Europe. Questions whether violation of the constitution occurred during the election of the assembly. This is more or less standard. Then its municipality can contest the constitutionality of laws, acts of government, diminishing the revenues when municipalities are affected by such law or act. So, which means assembly, municipality has the right to trigger proceedings before us on these counts. And we have had as one case, which is known as on the when assembly was authorized party, we've had what is known prison and logo case, whereby the court required the one of the municipalities to change the logo so that it reflects the feelings of all ethnicities living in that municipality. Then it's under 8-10 or more deputies of the assembly within 8 days from the date of adoption have the right to contest constitutionality of law or decision adopted by the assembly as regards substance and procedure followed. So that's because this has been a technical mistake. It's separate jurisdiction under which we have had famous case known as Pacoli, second president of Kosovo, during its mandate 5 years from now, because the court was established formally in February 2009, but in September effectively started to be operational. We have ruled against two cases of the heads of state of Kosovo. One was, I will be speaking later on it, President Sediu's case, which we found in violation of the Constitution as he was holding two positions, position of the head of state and as the leader of the party, which means that he was violating the Constitution, the constitutional principle of the unity, of constitutional and legal unity of the nation. As we all know in legal doctrine, there is, of course, always constitutional and legal unity of a nation. Sociological unity of a nation does not exist. In this famous polemic, for those of you who are familiar, between Carl Schmitt and Hans Kelsen, almost a century ago, 90 years or so ago, whereby ideas of Kelsen prevailed over the constitutional, over the sociological and political unity of the nation. Based on that, we said that our constitution requires the head of state to resign from every post because they should both in form and substance reflect the unity of the nation, and one of them is not holding both positions, or positions that would compromise that unity of the nation. Then it is, as I said, 30 or more deputies of the Assembly are authorized to refer the question of whether the President of Kosovo of the Republic has committed a serious violation of the Constitution, under which we ruled in the first case in 2010, as I said, finding that the court found that, that the head of state, that then head of state, Mr. Sediu, was violating the Constitution by holding both positions. Indirect jurisdiction refers to the individuals. We have what is known in German doctrine, Echte, full constitutional complaint, which means that individuals, as you see, can refer or authorize to refer violations by public authorities regarding the rights and freedoms guaranteed by the Constitution. It's Chapter 2 and 3 of the Constitution. Chapter 2 of the Constitution of Kosovo is universal human rights and fundamental freedoms. Chapter 3 is rights of the communities. In addition to the Chapter 2, in Kosovo there is a special chapter that protects non-majority communities, and it has a very elaborate and structured system of protection. But human rights through individual complaint can be protected only, they can file a case with us, only after they have exhausted all legal remedies, because we do not act as a court of fourth instance. We wait other, mainly judicial, mainly Supreme Court decisions. We wait until the procedure is exhausted, is done, and we see whether there have been any taint in the proceedings, both as far as material law and procedural law is concerned, and in exceptional cases, as well as far as the factual side of the story is concerned. Our individual complaint resembles Czech, German, and other practices, and this is 99 almost percent of our work. So, like with other constitutional courts that have individual complaint proceedings, us as well, we have this procedure which takes most of our time. Then is the issue what is known as incidental control. The courts have the right, while they decide a case or controversy, to stay proceedings and require the court that certain provision of a certain law or legal provision that is to be applied in a concrete case or controversy appears to them that it's not constitutional. If applied, they will produce unconstitutional consequences for the case and controversy that is being handled by them. So for this, and it's very classical jurisdiction, is known as incidental control, or incidental jurisdiction. The courts, regular courts, should stay proceedings and ask us. In Europe, Italy is, I would say, the kind of the most specialized on the issue of, and they have very diverse system of incidental control systems. So this is the issue of, as I said, on constitutional amendments. The president of the assembly, always he or she appears as authorized party before us. Whenever there is an amendment, speaker of the assembly has a duty, constitutional duty, to bring to our attention, to file a referral asking us and staying there the their adoption until we give a green light, as I said, as to their constitutionality. Additional jurisdiction says can be assigned by law. For example, law on general elections says that elections cannot be certified until all legal proceedings before constitutional court are over. Or law on local self-government, for example, has a special procedure in which mayor can be dismissed by the court order if the government suspends him or her temporarily for the violation of law, and then following that decision of the government, if the government requires the court to rule over that behavior of mayors, then according to the law, we can dismiss the mayor. So structure of the cases, as most of the cases, as in other countries that have been filed before us, appear inadmissible, mostly on procedural grounds. Since we don't require people to come before us through lawyer, they are always without lawyer, and even when there are lawyers, so usually they make procedural mistakes, or usually in most cases referrals are, as we say, manifestly ill-founded, because they couldn't make the case, usually on procedural grounds. Then abstract or review of laws and legal regulations has been only very small percentage, maybe 2 to 3% of the cases in our court. Key decisions, for example, so far have been what we say radio and television case. We put an interim measure on the radio and television of Kosovo 5 years ago, requiring €3 to be paid for each house, and we found that should stop until the new law is fixed so that it conforms to European standards on that. Prisoner logo case, as I said, that's the tale of two precedents, then first one and the second one, over which we ruled both. In both cases, we found unconstitutionality. PAC case is privatization agency case. Supreme Court of Kosovo has a special chamber which is composed of internationals, was composed then of internationals, ruling on privatization issues. What they did, they were applying laws of Kosovo 45, 75, depending on their will. As you know, Supreme Courts are, because it was part of the Supreme Court, every Supreme Court, one of key functions is to take care of the uniform application of laws of the nation. So in this they failed, and we found that by doing so in an arbitrary way, the special chamber of the Supreme Court was violating the basic principle of legal certainty and security of Kosovo citizens. Case of the ratification of the agreement concluding between Kosovo and Serbia. As you know, it's been for 2 years almost, or maybe more, that there is a dialogue. As a result of that dialogue, Kosovo reached an agreement with Serbia, which was brought before us for review. We said that our country, like almost without exception all countries of Europe, no constitutional court has authority to review an international agreement once ratified. Once ratified, international agreement cannot be subject to constitutional review, because as you know, Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties says that constitutional problems can be and should be addressed during the negotiating phase, during the conclusion of the treaty, but they cannot be an excuse to obstruct the execution of international obligation taken on bona fide grounds. The agreement was, as you know, one of the five manners of concluding an agreement is initialing. It was first initialed, subject to ratification in the respective assemblies. It was done by Kosovo Assembly and said, then we said, agreement cannot be subject to constitutional review, repressive review, as we say, repressive after it is concluded. And usually, as you know, there are two types of agreements, those who have self-executing nature and those who do not. If they have self-executing provisions, they apply directly. If they don't have, they have a law that should implement them. This is, apart from Britain, in almost all, and other countries who are modeled after Britain, British system, without exception. And the law, which was part law ratifying this agreement, we said that the law contains agreement which is ratione materia out of the scope of jurisdiction of the Constitutional Court. So with this, I might have omitted many things because it's 5 years experience we have had in every year we publish in three languages. This is just for your information. In addition to Albanian, Serbian, and Turkish, we publish in English. All our decisions are accessible in website. We have a bulletin which is in two volumes every year, each of them having 500 pages. So it would be very difficult for me to sum up everything in this type of lecture. I'm aware of that, so that's why I would thank you for your attention and expect your comments or questions. And I'm ready to be part of the discussion or comments and answering your questions. Thank you.
Mr. President, thank you very much for your interesting and comprehensive lecture, in which you first outlined the situation of constitutionalism under communist rule, under the very difficult Milosevic years of the Milosevic regime, and finally under the Anmik years. I think you made a very important point in saying that one of the most problematic aspects of these Anmik years was that all the power was concentrated in one hand, and this usually can lead to serious problems. And as we have seen, unfortunately, in Kosovo, it led to also to serious problems. Besides the good aspects, we also saw during these Anmik years. After that, you pointed out the daily work of the Constitutional Court, and finally mentioned some very important cases during the last years. Remarkable, especially, I think, is the what you pointed out, the case against two presidents. We have to take into account that the Constitutional Court only exists for 5 years, so this is very remarkable. And finally, the last point was the election case concerning the elections, parliamentary elections this year. As I'm a journalist, I'm very much interested in politics, of course, and this case leads us immediately into the fields of politics. So, but to finally reach my first question, I have to go 4 years back to the year 2010, when there was parliamentary election in Belgium. After this parliamentary election, it took exactly 540 days for the Belgians to have a new government. And if there wouldn't have been various reports in the newspapers, I think many Belgians wouldn't even have noticed that they didn't have a new government. And 4 years later, in June 2014, Kosovo elected a new parliament. And now we have almost 4 months after this election, and there's still no new government in sight. And if you take into account all the very crucial issues Kosovo is facing, for example, economic development, the relations with Serbia, or European integration, just to touch on three of the most important, I would make the point that 4 months having no new government for Kosovo is worse than 540 days for Belgium, because Kosovo is facing really hard issues these days. So, there has been some criticism concerning the decision of your court in also delaying the process of forming a new government, because you your court annulled the election of the president of the parliament. So, how do you counter this criticism, and how could you explain to the audience why you couldn't decide otherwise? Why you have, in this case, had to annul the election of the Speaker of the Parliament?
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, that's right. We ruled twice on the issue of elections, and I tend to believe that those two decisions have closed the circle of decision-making of the court as far as election goes. Elections were held, as you know, on the 8th of June, and were considered as free and fair, heavily supervised by our international partners and other actors in charge of it. The second decision had to do with the election of the Speaker of the Assembly, and we interpreted the provisions regarding the, as you saw, the jurisdiction in which eight or more deputies can trigger proceedings before us on every law or decision of the Assembly, both as far as procedure and form goes. You should know one thing, and this is crucial, that the court has interpreted the term majority versus minority in terms of political parties, coalitions, and the like, only for the purposes of constituting the assembly and forming the government, not following the creation or constitution of the assembly. Creation or constituting an assembly, more or less, is followed not only in Kosovo but elsewhere through standard procedures, always, without exception. Oldest man or woman or girl or whatever chairs and leads certain predetermined procedures, which then they vary according to the constitution and rules of procedure implementing the constitution. We, in first decision, we said that based on the Constitution of Kosovo and the law on general elections implementing provisions of the Constitution, the largest political party, coalition, and the like, despite the fact that the Constitution uses different terms, is that or are those that emerged from elections for the purposes of constituting the Assembly. Next day, following the Constitution, creation of the assembly, that can change, and usually it changes next day, or following that is different political dynamics. Then we found in the second decision that the largest, again we affirmed the first decision, largest coalition of the political party is the party that won relative majority, because in proportional system, everybody knows, in all its variants, it's difficult to win absolute majority in the elections. And this is more or less everywhere in countries which follow proportional system. Then we said, for the purposes of proposing the candidate, both for assembly and prime minister, not winning the post. Winning is a different story. It's an issue of political dynamics. We interpreted the constitution along with the precepts of and methodology of Georg Jelinek, which did it in mid of the 19th century, and which nothing changes ever since, textual interpretation of the text itself, which says party, largest party, for the purposes of constituting the assembly, is the one who emerged from the party or coalition or whatever you call it, that emerged from there. Whether they win absolute majority is utterly different story, for which we were neither asked nor we answered. The rest is issue of political process. But our constitution and regulation implementing the provisions of Article 64 of the Constitution regarding the Speaker of the Assembly require that party to propose. What happened there was that they dismissed, discharged the oldest Speaker of the Assembly. And as you know, you don't have to be a lawyer to understand the logic. You can discharge someone, dismiss someone that is charged through votes or different procedures. By default, every member that is the oldest, when the assembly is newly formed, chairs, he or she cannot be subject to outvote, to discharge, or whatever. Because it makes no sense, because that's the age, that's the general principle. And then proposal emerged, as we have said, from the party or coalition, which was not majority in terms of the election results. That's the logic of our constitution and our laws. This is just for the purposes we have defined, for the purposes of constituting the assembly, not for the purposes of majority, minority, and other dynamics that play afterwards. And the assembly is constituted only when all bodies are elected, Speaker of the Assembly and deputies, based on the proportional system which we have, as you know, some constitution, for example, Portugal, they have the whole system, they say, in their constitution, how the seats are distributed. We don't have it, but other law and general elections implements the provision of the constitution as far as proportional system is concerned. That's why we found the decision violated both form and procedure substance.
Do you think that the provisions in the Constitution concerning these issues are functional, or would you propose that there should be made some amendments to the Constitution in order to avoid conflicts like the one we see right now in the future?
Well, it's up to the Assembly in the future. If they think, once they are constituted, if they think that this interpretation of the court in the future would be a problem, they can change the constitution and rules of procedure. There have been criticism that we are interpreting rules of procedure. We have interpreted rules of procedure now and in the immunities case 2 years ago, only as far as constitutionality of those provisions implementing the constitution are concerned. Then we said 2 years ago that some aspects are not constitutional because they violated the provisions of the constitution on immunity of the MPs, because some people believe that they have immunity for everything. And we said, no, immunity is functional only as far as the duties of the MP as a member of the parliament is concerned. Likewise, now we interpreted those provisions just to say how much they match or do not match the provisions of the Constitution regarding the proportional system. What the Assembly will do in the future, I don't know. But if they think that those provisions of the Constitution are a problem in the future, it's their sovereign power to decide over that.
As it would be a little bit unfair to misuse my position here as a moderator to ask more questions, I would like to open the floor for your questions.
Thank you very much. I also have a question concerning this recent debate that was discussed now concerning the election of the Speaker of Parliament. Could you cite maybe again this article of the Constitution that talks about who has the right to nominate person of the Speaker of Parliament? Is it the party? The party that has
party,
the majority.
Coalition,
coalition. So, how is coalition defined?
It's defined as the law in general elections that defines it. It's that is registered and that has taken place in the elections. So, based on that, we define. It's Article 64.1. If you allow me, I will. Structure of the assembly. it's Article 64.1. The Assembly has 120 deputies elected by secret ballot on the basis of open lists. The seats in the Assembly are distributed amongst all parties, coalitions, citizens' initiatives, and independent candidates in proportion to the number of valid votes received by them in the election to the Assembly. So it's pretty clear. And as I said, proportional system, we have St. League and De Hond, some constitutions have either one or the other in their text. Some do not have it, but they have regulations and other bylaws implementing, because rules of procedure are adopted by two-third majority. So it's more or less like organic, it would be like organic law, having the force of an organic law.
Thank you very much for a very interesting lecture. I have two questions relating to the Council of Europe. It's a great victory for Kosovo to have been elected a member of the Venice Commission. And I congratulate you personally for being the member for Kosovo in the Venice Commission. I think this is a very good first step in becoming a member of the Council of Europe. Two questions. Number one, do you expect the Venice Commission to look into the constitution of Kosovo? And would you expect any proposals from their part? And second, you know, of course, that the European Convention on Human Rights is the basic law of Europe on human rights. You are not a member, therefore, it is not legally binding for you. But does your court take into account the European Convention and the judgment of the Strasbourg Court?
Thank you very much. Because I forgot my omission. I omitted a very important remark regarding the standing of the European Convention within our system. It's our constitutional duty, in fact. Article 53 of the Constitution says, and this you can see in every single decision of the court, which is 90%, as I said, has to do with human rights and fundamental freedoms. Interpretation of human rights provisions. Human rights and fundamental provisions guaranteed by this Constitution shall be interpreted consistent with the court decisions of the European Court of Human Rights. So that has been for us a tremendous help. This provision and this Constitution is, so that you know, has been drafted under a heavy supervision and help of the Venice Commission and expertise of our partners from beyond the Atlantic. So our international friends from Euro-Atlantic legal community have been very much instrumental in defining this, and Venice Commission, I repeat, was one of them. This provision is inserted with the main goal, which I believe they have achieved, to help Kosovo restructure itself along the European lines on human rights and fundamental freedoms. So every single decision that we render, we quote case law of European Court on Human Rights. Besides, with the help of the Council of Europe and financed by Swiss government, we have a donation which every 5 years we send there two legal advisors. We have nine legal advisors, six Albanians, seven Albanians and two Serbs. For example, now in Strasbourg, we have two interns. Every 5 months, for two coming years, they will go in practice there, doing training there for 5 months, each of our legal advisors, so that, because legal drafting is mostly done under our guidance, under guidance of the judges by them. So that has been an immense help for us. Kosovo having no, as I said, because that constitutional court was just like every communist constitutional court in Yugoslavia or Poland, for example, for that matter, was you know, maverick in a sense, in terms of modern constitutionalism. So we had no practice to look upon. Inserting this provision and giving Kosovo individual complaint proceedings of a full type, like Czechs have and some other European countries, helped us a lot to in our decision making, because all we had to do is to study, which we do. We have a library hard copy, for example, which is German donation, which is the best, I'm sure, in the neighboring countries with Kosovo. And we have unlimited access to Westlaw through the help of one of our American judges. We have three international judges. One is American, one is Portuguese, one is Bulgarian. The American judge mediated with the Westlaw in Minnesota. It's third year that they donate free of charge to us access to legal sources of Westlaw, which is basically to every legal source. So we do extensive research. Our legal advisors and judges, legal advisors without exception, they are educated in foreign societies. They speak, in addition to English, German, French, Swedish, depending on the country where they are educated. So they have no problem to access foreign sources in original language. So as to the issue of the Venice Commission, as I said, I expect that we will, Kosovo might refer in the future, you know, for advice, as many other countries have done, and of course we will be part of. We have just now received, I would almost mention, a country, because they have asked an expertise from us the other day, from Constitutional Court, a letter addressing me to share with them our experience regarding interim measures, which we have plenty of experience in that regard. And by the end of this month, we will send them a report. So Kosovo will be a serious player in the Venice Commission.
Just a short follow-up to this. You, Mr. President, you just mentioned the fact that three members of the Constitutional Court are international judges. So are there some provisions when this will phase out, when it will be made up only of Kosovo judges?
Yes, I will. Their mandate ended 2 years ago, and then it was extended two more years until August this year.
Extended by whom?
Extended by ICO. It was International Civilian Mission then. So then what happened is, as you know, Kosovo reached an agreement through the exchange of notes. One of the mechanisms to conclude an international agreement, as you know, is exchange of letters constituting agreement. That's Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties. Our president, Madame Yahyaga, sent exchange letters with the Baroness Ashton during last year several times. Then they reached an agreement which was ratified by two-thirds majority in assembly that extended the mandate of ULEX for two more years, our judges and legal advisors for two more years, and founded the special court, as you know, which will start, I guess, next year, January, February. So, and now the debate in Kosovo goes about their legality, whether in the constitution of Kosovo, international treaties have higher force than constitution. It's not the issue of hierarchy in this case. It's the issue of the constitution, which says Kosovo respects international law. And every serious country would respect that. If you conclude an agreement, and international law is composed, main source of international law is international agreement. If you reach an international agreement, you should execute it bona fide. Otherwise, you will be in breach of international law, and you may pay huge amounts of money if you obstruct international obligations. So Kosovo has ratified that a few months ago with two-thirds majority. It's required because it's transfer of sovereignty. With that agreement, Kosovo transferred sovereignty to ULEX and to International Special Court for certain jurisdictional issues, including the mandate, extension of the mandate for two more years for ULEX judges and judges of the Constitutional Court and legal advisors of the court, which we have three. We have three legal advisors as well.
How would you evaluate the current state of affairs in terms of rule of law and observance of human rights? What would you stress as a major achievement implemented so far, and in which areas you see a room for further improvement?
I forgot as well to note that Constitutional Court has, in terms of referrals, very diverse structure in terms of ethnicity. 3% of all referrals are non-Albanians, filed by non-Albanians. We have very often cases where Serbs file referrals against Serbs. I'm always speaking about local Serbs, Kosovo Serbs. We've had cases just months ago that a Serb, Kosovo Serb, who fled to Serbia, her property was through the Constitutional Court restituted. We have another case, it was reported in Serb media as well. We have cases in Gjilan area of Gjilan likewise. Constitutional Court, based on the nationality of those who filed, ethnicity of those who filed referrals, is for sure the institution that non-majority communities trust the most. We have had, in average, in percentage, inadmissible cases, like we have other cases for, as I said, for procedural reasons. In terms of the composition of the court as well, we have almost 50-50 as far as gender is concerned, and then non-Albanians compose around 30% of the court. Mostly is Serb, local Serb or Kosovo Serb community. As far as judicial system in general goes, we have quashed several decisions of Supreme Court of Kosovo, which we considered violated the right to free and fair trial of the local Serb or Serb citizens. I don't want to mention into details on different grounds, either arbitrariness, for example, or there were cases in which local Serbs had no idea that it was ruled against them, because they live inside Serbia. So as far as the court is concerned, I believe that we have the best record, I'm sure, in the region, not only in Kosovo in that regard, in professional terms. However, general situation in Kosovo, compared to how it was years ago or decades ago, I think it's by far better. We have the lack of conflict, animosities. Local Serbs now have joined, as you know, in addition to elections, have joined institutions. We were the first among very few where Serbs started to apply 5 years ago. Then we had problems to fulfill legal criteria whereby there should be at least 2 to 3 candidates, for example. Now that problem does not exist. The issue of the north remains precarious because it's 15 years that people have had their parallel life in general sense, so that it takes time until those agreements that were concluded in Brussels under the EU auspices start implementing. In terms of customs, there is progress, for example. In terms of re-establishment of court system, there is progress. Policing is more or less now the same. It takes time, but I would say security. Since I'm at the same time political scientist, I would say security. We, in terms of general security, I would say that more needs to be done, so that local non-majority population doesn't feel ostracized. And the same applies to the northern Kosovo, for example. Majority of the Albanians cannot move. It's not that there is violent conflict going there, it's over. That part has been slowly is being integrated, but the issue of fear is what divides communities. And I think that will take a bit of time, but I'm pretty optimistic that in general, citizens of Kosovo have a brighter European future.
Regarding the establishment of jurisdiction of Constitutional Court over international organizations, moreover, subsidiary organs of international organization to review the violation of human rights in Kosovo. What would be the outcome in such case, and would that be a change in international setting regarding the keeping international organization accountable? The second question is, what happened with preparatory travaux for Constitution of Kosovo, why they haven't disclosed or mentioned in recent decisions of Constitutional Court.
Thank you. Let me note that international organizations operating in Kosovo have immunity in all spheres. We have had cases, and we have declared ourselves with a lack of jurisdiction, ratione materia. We cannot, because that's the, I mean, can you imagine UN or other international organizations operating elsewhere without immunity? It would be, we have had cases in which we ruled as with our decisions declared that we have no jurisdiction, ratione materia. As to the preparatory works leading to the adoption of the Constitution or travaux préparatoires, we have had several cases in our decisions where we say the court did not possess, despite the fact that we have asked the Assembly to present us with one, if they have it. You should know one thing, travaux préparatoires or preparatory works are not legal source, as we say, as a lawyer. They are not legal source. They cannot be quoted by us as the single source. They help in what is called original interpretation or to disclose, to guess original intent of the drafters. And I've seen laymen in Kosovo saying that we on purpose don't want to find them. Maybe some people in Kosovo have them. Maybe some foreign dignitaries have them. But apart from being sealed and signed by the Assembly of Kosovo, we cannot receive travaux préparatoires from anyone else on earth. We might know that they are there or there, but we don't, what we have to do with travaux préparatoires, which are in private hands, or even at the hands of other institutions other than Assembly, because government might have them, some ministers might have them, for example, but it's the Assembly as the owner of the Constitution, formally, that should have them. If they don't have them, it's okay. As they say to us, we always ask them, they say, we don't have them. We don't have them, meaning in the archives. Imagine if we would follow the logic of some critics, and every time we decide something, they will say, look, I found travaux préparatoires in a shelf in my house or in the house of certain people who were in the Constitutional Commission that drafted the Constitution. Imagine that. And you see what was their intent. Their intent was exactly the one we want now to achieve. Those who say so, if they are sincere, if they really have them, they should disclose now, at this moment. So if the case emerges after 1 year or 2 years, if they are published even in a newspaper, then people will read, say, well, this was written 2 years ago. No one knew that this problem would emerge, for example. And then they would be credible to influence the process. But you will never be credible to influence the process if you refer to certain preparatory works or to certain original intent of the drafters when the crisis emerges. Because it's very simple. But, I repeat, as a constitutional court, we are not allowed, neither any court on earth, to operate or to make use of preparatory works which are not or which do not stem from the Assembly, from the legislative body. It's logical.
I'm studying political sciences, and I have a question for you. You talked about the Constitutional Court's role on rule of law, especially in transition countries such as Kosovo, and for good job that the Constitutional Court of the Republic of Kosovo is doing. During my stay here in Austria, I have had the opportunity to compare and to learn that there is a clear difference between the meaning of a good job in post-communist or transition countries and in countries with established democratic systems. In the Constitutional Court's latest verdict, you mentioned that the Constitutional Court does not have the necessary preparatory materials of the drafting of the Constitution that would help with understanding the objectives of the ones who drafted the Constitution. This is similar with the robbery in the evidence room at the police station, main police station, an act which bears penal responsibility for authorized officials, for the archives, as well as for the head of the committee for the drafting of the Constitution, Mr. Haridin Kushi. Therefore, which specific job you are referring to, especially since many people think that latest Constitutional Court verdict has made the political crisis worse, as Mr. Moderator mentioned. But in addition, you mentioned the case with Mr. President Seydiou, who was in conflict with two positions, something, yeah.
Right.
What's the case now with the Prime Minister and with his executive? He's a member of parliament, he's a part of the executive, and so why you are not acting in this case? Thank you.
Right.
And the third question, respected sir, you mentioned the
Venice Commission.
Commission. And here is, in this time that we are having really political problems in Kosovo, and we are really concerned because of tensions, you recently, this time you got that position. Is it kind of making favor each other to the Prime Minister and, thank you.
Now, constitutional courts in former Yugoslavia, in former communist world, used to act sua sponte, as we say, on their own initiative. Our court and courts in Europe have no right to themselves activate, okay? We have no right. We might see there, it's like with ordinary courts. Maybe now somebody is killing someone there. But if the state doesn't act, public prosecutor, and catch him, he might go with impunity as long as he lives. So the same is with us. We don't act on our own initiative. Only one institution has constitutional sanction in Kosovo, head of state. Only he or she can be dismissed because of the violation of the constitution. Others, no. Slovenia has for MPs, for example. In Slovenia, you can sanction as well MPs. You can rule against MPs, members of the parliament. In Kosovo, no. Neither the prime minister nor ministers. If they violate the constitution, they are responsible before the law, not before the constitution. They might go to prison if they make mistakes, you know, or whatever. So as to the issue of Venice Commission, you should ask government why they sent my name. I had no idea. They asked me, would you give your CV? I said, of course I will. So I did. As to the travaux préparatoire, I'm again repeating the question. Constitutional court here in Austria, anywhere, because we are not drafters of the constitution. We interpret this. It's conflict of interest for us to have preparatory work in our archives. You understand? We do not have the right to have those documents in our archives. Every time, hypothetically, if they were in the assembly, each and every time we would need them, we would ask the assembly, give us preparatory work to this chapter, for example, or to this article. If they would give us all files, stamped, signed, we would not bother them next time, but we would go in our archives and see the copies. But I repeat, preparatory works that are at the private hands or at the hands of the government or whatever other institution apart from the assembly are not valid reference for constitutional court. It's very simple. It's for lawyers, those who are lawyers, it's very easy to understand. Because we would be manipulated if, imagine, imagine after 1 year, next problem arises. Depending on the daily interest, they will say, look, majority means different things, not what you say now. Look what we said there. They can fabricate those. That's why they are called preparatory works, which are shelved with the drafter and the key institution, which is called legislative body, which is assembly. They are the only ones, if they have them. If they don't have them, it's their right. They might not have them for a million reasons. For us, it's important that we do not have them from them. Others, they can, if they are serious, they can write scientific, scholarly paper. Why they don't write it? If you really think that you have them, do it on paper somewhere. Publish it, I want to see it. Or scholars would like to see it. Those of you who are familiar, they know, for example, we were criticized on the issue of the head of state. I published last year, no, 2 years ago, immediately following the criticism in the Vienna Journal of International Constitutional Law. It's published, Protection of the Head of State, the case of Kosovo. And I shared those views because we have, according to the law, every right to share our views for academic purposes, which have no financial implication. I published that. And I still, you know, we were criticized that we protected head of state, current president Yayaga. Nationalists know it. The story was this. There were a political agreement which political forces reached following the second decision on Pazzoli case, which said that Madame Yayaga would be next president. She swore in with 2/3 majority of the votes. Then what happened? All, and then we were criticized by all, not by certain, by all political forces in Kosovo. That we are, well, and then they drafted a constitutional amendment, 11. One of them said, the current president should go home 6 months following the adoption of these amendments. And then, based on comparative, as we do in, look at our decision, every our decision is based on comparative perspective, without exception. And then we said, some constitutions, for example, South Korea has a specific provision which bans dismissal of constitutional organs before their mandate, if the constitution is changed, before the mandate ends. Or France in 2000, when they changed from 7 to 5 years terms of the presidency, since it was left by De Gaulle, it was said this amendment is valid only for those who come following the end of mandate of the current president. Imagine, had we said this amendment is constitutional, what would happen? Every time politics would gather and make amendments, and next day change the constitution, composition of the constitutional court, then they would change the chamber, they would, you know. That's why rule of law, without in liberal constitutional democracies, ruled by majority is constitutional only if it follows certain predetermined procedures and legal rules. Majority without rules, anarchy and chaos. And history of Europe, since you are political scientist, is the best example of that, from almost, without exception, of every single democracy in Europe. Then we were criticized by, and they said, the court said that the mandate gave Madame Yayaga, current president, 5 years mandate. We didn't give it. They gave, because she swore in for 5 years. Political agreement has no meaning for constitutional court when we evaluate constitutional provisions. Political implications of our decision, likewise, we have said this, no matter that politics should address those things, not us. They should take care whether the country goes this way or that way. We rule based on the text of the Constitution and, as I said, comparative practice. There is no decision of the court which has been rendered by majority Albanians versus others. Always, all decisions, you will have nationals, meaning Albanians, non-Albanians, plus internationals. Either it will be consensual or the decision will always have a mixture of votes from Albanians, non-Albanians, and internationals. And always, for example, the last one is 44 pages. How can you say that it's politically influenced? How can you reason something which you don't believe? When you have thoughts that are not serious, you do it in 2-3 pages and it's very obvious. How can you compare your constitution with others if you don't believe those values? Of course, sometimes we have been criticized that we are influenced by internationals, which is absolutely not true. Why it looks so? It looks because values of this constitution are values of Austria, of Germany, of Czech Republic, of all Euro-Atlantic legal community. We expound this constitution, not other customary law or local law or whatever that coexists still in society of Kosovo. And constitutional court, as in Hungary, in Czech Republic, in Bulgaria, in other former communist countries, is playing a crucial role in reframing our society along the values of Western constitutionalism.
You are an optimist, like the majority of people of Kosovo are people who believe in the future, and it seems that the future looks good, but I mean, a lot of things have to be done, and the power you have, and the Supreme Court of Kosovo has to be used maybe in the way that, in the big picture, because now you are in the middle, in the center, from the political point of view, what's happening right now. But there are other issues that are important in the long term. And how successful have you done that job? Not only you, the previous president of the Supreme Court and others to come, concerning the society of Kosovo. And the second question would be, as Mr. Dums, right, from the newspaper here, from the press, we had an article just a few days ago from a journalist who was criticizing actually the decision you have made concerning these political issues that are, from right now, are important, but in the big picture, maybe they are not important. He mentioned, I was reading actually just today, I'm just gonna check and see, because he really goes further, and two of them, the student who is studying here from Kosovo and the journalist, are going in the same direction. You know, it's not only about the decisions you are making, but I just wanna quote, it's really short, it says, doch auch das Verfassungsgericht ist sich nicht einig. Eine der drei internationalen Richter im neuen Kopfigen Gremium der Amerikaner in dem Fall ist zurückgetreten. Das haben sie heute nicht genannt, weil die Entscheidung für falsch hält. Manche kritisieren, dass die lokalen Richter unter Druck der PDK stehen würden. Die Besetzung des Parlamentssprechers wäre ein Schritt zur Bildung einer Regierung. Okay.
The main point is that the
end of quote. This is in German. I'll I'll translate it in
English. Just in summarize it. You don't have to translate.
I'll summarize it. It says that the Constitutional Court is kind of unanimous. One of the three international judges is the American one resigned because he thinks that the decision is wrong from his point of view, and that's fine, I think. But he goes further and said that some complains that the local judges would be under pressure from the PDK. And how true is that, that political influence is in
right.
the court? Because I kind of disagree with these journalists, but maybe a lot of people agree with him.
Right.
And the third question would be concerning the right of speech in Kosovo. We know that, you know, a religion in one side and other issues will come to your desk in the future, which means that I remember one time in Germany we were dealing with the police department in Hamburg and Berlin concerning a case. You know, we had a web page that they were using hate speeches in their web page, and it was not only one web page, it was a religious web page, but there was another web page, wing right web page. And then the police, the department tried to do something in that issue. What can we do to stop it? But stopping it was not possible because the server was located not even in Europe, and the case was in Germany. And have you had these kind of cases concerning the hate speech, and how would you deal in the future? Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. I'm satisfied as far as the work of the institution I lead and colleagues goes, not with the general climate in political terms in Kosovo or economic hardships. That's not my responsibility. We have, as I said, played our part in framing Kosovo along the Western standards of the rule of law. And I assure you that our decisions, and I again repeat, are in our website, accessible from wherever you are. You can match them with, I'm not speaking about neighboring countries, but they can match decisions in terms of reasoning, because that's our power, reasoning. We have well-structured reasoning which follows Western standards and is really measurable by those standards. And it's not me who is saying only, it's others, because it's been extensively written in academic circles about the Constitutional Court of Kosovo, both in Europe and outside, for example, in Harvard and Yale, which are pretty, of course, here and there criticism, but for most part, our decisions mirror Western standards of constitutionalism. I didn't have predecessor because I'm the first, 5 years ago, I'm first president, and the court of Constitutional Court, as I said, was founded in 2009, and I don't have all we model ourselves as European Court on Human Rights. That's our, in fact, I would say, that's our main reference point to which we look. As for the issue of American judge, that's not true that he resigned. It was absolutely media story. The American colleague, American judge, disagreed with the terms for personal reasons of his stay in Kosovo. His mandate was extended by the head of state based on an international treaty. For quite personal reasons, he said that I cannot accept at this moment. Then, in the meantime, he is underway to agree new terms of his contract, which is very legitimate, with the with ULES, and he is coming on the first, hopefully first, second of October. He is starting incessantly. There was no interruption in his work. He never resigned. He went back home, as international judges do after sessions. When we complete sessions, they go and see their families for a week. And he had some technical problems. He is now back. And that's the story. Media speculation about his disagreement with the majority and the like, that has nothing to do with that. We have a system, like in Western societies, of dissent. We have the right, like in every country in the West, majority countries, to do dissent. If I disagree with majority, I do dissent. But that has nothing to do with the respect for the majority decision and other colleagues. And every dissent says respectfully disagrees with the majority opinion, meaning that they don't mix private thoughts with the obligatory nature of the majority decision of the majority. Hate speech, we didn't have so far. That issue falls mainly in the jurisdiction of the criminal courts, ordinary courts, and we don't have, as you saw, direct jurisdiction over that issue. It might come before us in the future, but maybe not that as a hate speech, but it may come as the right to free and fair trial was violated by someone who was, for example, sentenced for hate speech. We have cases going on which might cover parts of the hate speech, but I cannot say more at this stage because it's under investigation. I know for those cases, as much as you know, or as much as it was reported, in media.
My question is the last verdict 119-14 as the constitutional basis for the case has called upon the Article 64-1. It is clear that this constitutional disposition explains the methodology of the seating arrangements at the Assembly and not necessarily the political formations in the Assembly. So, this provision should be handled by the Central Election Commission during the certification of the mandates and not by the Assembly as a basis of the reflection of the represented political forces. So, during the interpretation of the dispositions of Article 64, paragraph 1, why has the Constitutional Court not mentioned the subparagraph 1 and 2 of this article, which prove that this article presents only the methodology of the sitting arrangement in the Assembly and not the constitutional basis for the identification of the biggest parliamentary group?
I'm not allowed to comment decision because that's public, that's done. So I cannot say why we didn't say this or that because that would be commenting the decision.
So before closing the panel and going to the informal part of the evening, I would have a very last question concerning this international special court you already mentioned. There was, some, as we all know, much pressure from the side of the international community to establish this court, which should tackle possible crimes committed by the KLA in the years 1999 and 2000. And the international pressure sends, I think, a rather problematic message. Because this message is that the international community doesn't think that or doesn't trust the Kosovo judicial institutions to handle these cases by themselves. So what's your, and there were also some politicians claiming that this court was an insult to Kosovo, and some of them changed their minds afterwards. But I would be very curious to ask you for your opinion on this special court.
Again, I, on that issue, I know as much as you know, and that was published in media, but the raison d'etre of the establishment of that was, as you know, part of an international report which was done by Mr. Marty, and then it triggered the international investigation which was done through the agreement of Kosovo, Albania, and other neighboring countries because it affects the region. I likewise know that, as you know, it was part of international obligation of all former Yugoslav republics, including Kosovo, to try war crimes or crimes against what we say international law in general. That was at least my understanding of the way a government of Kosovo and Albania were approaching it. And of course, by default, since you have to establish something which operates mostly outside, it shows that, as it is said in the statute and in the papers leading to the proposal for the establishment of the court, it says that ULEX and other national authorities failed to address certain concerns because of mostly because of the lack of procedural guarantees related to witnesses. This was made public, and I have no reason not to believe that. And besides, it was again voted with 2/3 majority, and those who have had those concerns should have aired and said that in the assembly or expressed their will. But since it is with 2/3, you think 2/3 majority is what is called constituent majority, by which the constitution is changed, meaning that there is a general opinion that that's necessary for the benefit of Kosovo. This is my reading of those 2/3 of those votes. In fact, it was 90 beyond that, 90 or so votes that voted for the establishment of the tribunal, special tribunal.